My plan is to continue with this lecture for about an hour and then answer questions, which I trust can also be available. Is there a box of some kind being passed around? In our present lecture, we are concentrating first on Christ's temptation by the devil. The reason is that in our following of Christ and imitation of the Savior, most of us would not even realize that part of the following of Christ is also learning from Him two facts. If the Son of God, when He became man, was tempted by the devil, so are we. And secondly, we are to learn from Him how to cope with the evil spirit in our lives. First, the narrative itself. Found in the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Christ's temptation by the devil took place after our Lord had been baptized by John. And whatever else we know, let's make sure we know Christ did not have to be baptized. It is commonly taught, without being defined by the church, how the sacrament of baptism was instituted either when Christ was baptized or when He commissioned the apostles, go and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. We may therefore hold that the sacrament of baptism was instituted, repeat, we may hold when Christ Himself was baptized. The baptism of our Lord opened His public ministry, but the actual opening of His ministry was His temptation by the evil spirit. And notice the three temptations to which the devil subjected the Savior. If you are who you claim you are, command these stones to be made into bread. And Christ answered, not by bread alone does man live, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Notice the devil was not sure that Jesus was what Christ claimed to be. Part of the devil's motive for tempting the Savior was to find out who this Jesus really is. But mind you, this was after the devil had kept an eye on Jesus for 30 years. Christ was no stranger to the devil. Then, whether in reality or in imagination, the devil led Christ to the top of the temple. And again, what the devil was after was to find out whether Christ was, well, either the Messiah or, even more seriously, the Son of God. He was therefore telling the Savior, on the first case and the second case, to work a miracle. And notice Christ's answer, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. How that word, tempt, needs to be understood. We know that God wants us to do His will. And our main duty in life for the mind is to know what God wants. And with our wills, to choose to do it. What would be tempting God? Tempting God would be to, well, attempt. Notice the word, attempt. To do something which is humanly impossible, that would call upon God to work a miracle in our favor. Over the years, in teaching 14 years in New York, I've more than once been at the peak of the large buildings, 85, 90 stories in New York City. And I was told each time that I had visitors there, that many people, the numbers are never advertised to publicize their suicide, throw themselves from the top of, say, the Empire State Building. Would we be justified by saying, Lord, I believe you are God. I'm going to throw myself down from the Empire State Building. It's up to you, Lord. You work the miracle. You spare me as I coast down to the streets of Manhattan. I don't want to anticipate too much of what the lessons are. But it is most important to know how much grace we have for what we believe God wants us to do. Because to attempt to do more than God intends for us, you would be tempting Him, in effect telling him what to do. Now watch this. Does God work miracles? He sure does. When does He work miracles? When we carry into practice what He wants us to do. Am I clear? No matter how difficult, how humanly impossible the task may be, the first and primary condition is that we know it is God's will. That assurance, we never ask God, how will I do something? All you need to know is whether He wants you to do it. It looks humanly impossible. So what? Third temptation. Christ was led by the devil to a high mountain. And the devil said to Him, all these things I will give you if you fall down and worship me. And then the famous words of our Lord, quoted now over the centuries, "Be gone, Satan." the Lord your God shall you worship, and him alone shall you serve. Over the years, I have lectured many hours over Christ's temptation, but I just thought, introduce our subject, building on the narrative in the Gospels. One of the lessons First lesson, the devil exists, he tempts everyone. We are all tempted by the devil. I don't want to overdo the verb, but this temptation by the devil is part of all life here on earth. In other words, we are, none of us, ever exempt from being tempted by the evil spirit. And I would add, it was not in the notes, the devil exists. He tempts everyone, everywhere, and only God knows how universally I should use the word always. Secondly, the devil uses people to do his work. Now this needs to be said. The devil uses other human beings to lead us into sin. And over the years I've told people, every person in mortal sin, one of my favorite definitions of a person in mortal sin, every person in mortal sin is an agent of the devil. And then, of course, the people whom the devil uses, maybe, what a safe statement, people who are very dear and near to us. And then we have the difficult task, which, remember, Adam had. He used Eve. And his great love of Eve darkened his mind, and he gave in. Not to know the devil uses human beings to tempt other people is not to know the ABCs of Christian spirituality. As you go through this course, you'll see much more. Number three, the devil is deceitful. He wants to bring us to hell with himself. But notice the word deceitful. The primary temptation of the devil is with a mind. The main way in which, over the centuries, the devil has successfully seduced so many people, so many nations, is by deceiving them under the semblance of truth what the devil knew was a demonic lie. And that is why I never tire repeating Marshall McLuhan's, I call it a definition of the modern media. By now you must know it by heart. The modern media are engaged in Luciferian conspiracy against the truth. All sin begins in the mind, even as all virtue begins in the mind. And the media are demonically successful in deceiving people that what is a sin is either not a grave sin or is no sin at all. And that is why whatever you people do is between you and the Lord. But I would tell you, whatever you do in God's name, examine your consciences on your reading and your watching of the media. Either you watch your reading, you watch what you see on television, hear on the radio, or now get on the computer, or as sure as there is a God in heaven, you'll be seduced by the devil. I think I should share this with you. From when I began my studies in the Society of Jesus, especially in theology, 4 years in what we call undergraduate theology, and then 2 years in Rome, I knew, thank God, I foresaw something of the kind of world I was being ordained a priest for. As a consequence, I realized it won't be enough for me to just know what the church teaches. I better know also what the devil teaches. And the devil teaches on a high academic level. Kant, Hegel, Nietzsche, geniuses. The standard fare of every state university in America. And I didn't want to waste my time on amateur heretics. For years, reading, for example, Martin Luther's writings, John Calvin's writings. And I say this because I want to help you. I would never read, I don't say a book or even a page without first saying a prayer. And my friends, I still do this today. Am I making sense? Those geniuses were used by the evil spirit, were used, are being used. And you better make sure you are ready when you expose your mind to what those demonic intellects are writing or saying. And sometimes in the middle, for example, of reading in John Calvin, I would pause and pray for light. The devil is extraordinarily shrewd and be able to mask untruth and make a lie seem to be a beautiful, divinely revealed truth. And the devil is organized. This course could be on the organization of the devil. I could speak not just for 8 lectures, for 8 months. During my graduate studies, getting a doctorate in theology in Rome, you choose your director before you go to Europe, and you plan beforehand what you're going to write on your dissertation. So my plan was to write on the devil as the organizer of evil in the modern world. I had only 2 years to do my classes and thesis. I was dissuaded by the director not to undertake the subject. Abortion. He is highly organized, and the genius behind the organization is Satan. To think that's pious rhetoric is to be living in a dream world. As you may know, St. Augustine wrote a famous book, in fact, the greatest book of his life. It is called, remember, The City of God, Civitas Dei. A very fascinating book to read. He was writing in the, well, in the last half of the 20th century. Even as Christ, what did he do when God became man? He was not satisfied with just becoming a man or just, say, preaching his gospel to the people in Palestine. No, he formed, what shall I call it, an organization, otherwise known as the Roman Catholic Church. So the fathers of the church teach no less than Christ founded the mystical body, which we call the mystical body of Christ. So there is the mystical body of Satan. The devil is highly organized, and hear it. And the principal organized society which the devil has used over the centuries is the state. Don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying that the civil government, the state, is the city of Satan. What I am saying is that the devil, over the centuries, since Calvary, has been using the state as the organized, very successful effort of the evil spirit to not just seduce people into sin, but to order them, govern them, rule them by sin. That is why I told my students over the years, of all people to be identified by name in the Apostles' Creed, oh no, Christ, remember, is identified. Mary is identified. God the Father is identified. God the Son is identified. God the Holy Spirit is identified. And who else?
Pontius Pilate.
To tell Christians until the end of time, the devil used Pilate. Whom did the devil possess? Judas, remember? But the Jews could not. Oh, they hated Christ because he was the one who in their minds claimed to be the Messiah. What kind of a Messiah is this? We want the kingdom of Israel. We want political power. This pious preacher, sure, he works what, well, look like miracles. He even raises the dead. So what? We don't want a Messiah that tells us that his kingdom is not of this world. And the Pilates of history have been the crucifiers, no longer of Christ, who was crucified on Calvary, but of Christ's followers ever since. That, I repeat, is the teaching of the church. The devil adapts himself to people, playing on their weaknesses. And he watches us very carefully. He knows us better, far better than we think he does. And one benefit from your classes here at the Guado, it'll make you more conscious of the devil and to protect yourselves from the evil spirit. My speaking to you and your patiently listening would have been worthwhile. Except for the devil, no way, because the Catholic Church has fallen into the most serious crisis of our 2,000 years of history. The devil has been phenomenally successful, especially in seducing bishops, priests, and religious. How well I know. So much. We go on. Now, something of the method of the devil. Notice what we're doing. We are drawing on Christ's temptation by the evil spirit and learning lessons which now 20 centuries of the church's wisdom has taken from Christ's temptation to teach Christ's followers. To follow Christ means to know the wiles of the evil spirit. Notice the first method. I call it A. The first method is passions of the body. The devil did not really know, because the devil, what a safe statement, the devil does not have the true faith. And consequently, the devil knowing human nature. And Jesus was surely human. So the devil, therefore, tempted Christ by, well, urging him, this is Christ. Remember to change what? Stones into bread. Now the devil is smart, but he's not too smart. And always keep in mind, the devil does not have the true faith. And so he figured, how long had Jesus been fasting?
40 days.
How did Jesus fast without eating?
40 days.
You're not to imitate Christ, by the way. Do not eat for 40 days or 40 nights. But Christ did work miracles. In this case, the miracle of sustaining his body, even though he did not eat, may safely see or drink for 40 days. They never watched Jesus for 40 days. This man must be very hungry. And then the devil, we are saying, he uses, what did he use? He now uses what he did with Christ. He is just, you might say, symptomatic. What the devil now does, he uses luxury, food and drink, entertainment, and sex. Now his purpose is not only to lure people into, say, luxurious living, or having a lot of food and drink. I've said, I'm sure, more than once, my French Jesuit companions in Rome told me, our social scientists tell us, the whole country of France could be fed every year easily on what you Americans waste in food every year. The most fed nation in the world. All kinds of things that we have access to. Last night, through a misunderstanding, I was to be picked up at 7:30, going back to my rectory. Well, nobody showed. So I shopped around and, well, I got a driver. And I didn't think I'd see this. It's not in my notes. I was in the order, final vows, teaching theology. I didn't know how to ride a car, drive a car. So my Jesuit superior said, John, look, by now you should know how to drive a car. So, on obedience, appointed another priest to teach this Jesuit theologian how to drive a car. I know I can prove it. I drove 17 miles with my teacher next to me down an empty street, one of the suburbs of Chicago. But just then, there were three almost fatal accidents among Jesuits who learned how to drive a car when they were, well, up in years, beyond their teenage years. So I asked my Jesuit provincial, Father, can I be excused from driving a car? Why? I explained. I had to keep explaining. Funny, I convinced him. All right. You won't have to learn how to drive a car. I'm just illustrating. You go to Calcutta. There are cars in Calcutta. There are 13 million people in that city. I'm guessing. I don't have the statistics. I doubt if 100,000 have a car. All I can tell you is the devil uses our bodily desires. His aim, of course, is at our souls. And he is phenomenally successful. And the way he tempted our Lord is to teach us how he tempts human beings. Entertainment, sex, you may have heard these two words, almost proverbs in the Latin language. They are panes and circenses. Panes et circenses. Bread and entertainment. The Roman Empire enslaved most of its people. In other words, most of the Romans were supported, I'm speaking especially of the city and the environs of Rome, were supported by the government. Provided with food and entertainment. And part of that entertainment, as we know, for the first 300 years was the Christians entertaining the Romans, being thrown to the lions in the Colosseum. All I can say is, and I'm speaking first for myself, we have a lot, an awful lot to learn about the tactics of the devil. In my last conversation with Mother Teresa in Calcutta, I was there, as I think I've told you, last fall, again this past winter, and now this month. And one of the things we discussed was how the missionaries of charity are forbidden to have any television ever in any of their convents. Father, she said, whatever you can do, protect my sisters in the years to come from being, enslaved by the media. Sex. How wise the devil is. Here I could speak for not again just hours, but days. What is called rhetorically sex education. Oh, it's sex education, all right. But it is education in sex. And of course, masked under, even among Catholics, masked as a means of teaching even young children from their first grade about elements and factors of our human physiology, which is exposing the children to temptations long before they reach the age of even realizing how they're being seduced. All sex education in every country has been carefully planned by Planned Parenthood, and Catholics, oh what fools we can be, have become, shall I say, willing victims of this seduction. In the tone of Mother General in Philadelphia, Pontifical Community, the Cardinal Archbishop of Philadelphia told the Catholic teachers to teach sex education. He said, "Mother, please tell the Cardinal." "No, but he's the Cardinal." "Sure he's the Cardinal, but he's mistaken. Tell him." She didn't listen. I told her, "It's not just the children that are subjected to this sex education. It's your sisters. Your community will dissolve. Do you hear me?" She heard me all right, but she did not believe me. I was right. Now, we're talking about the method of the devil. Use the body to reach the soul. Second, the demonic method is the neglect of prayer. The most common form is tempting God as though we could do things that God requires without prayer. There's no way any of us can survive as Catholics, no matter what our state of life is, without prayer. And the more demanding our state of life, the more prayer and the more zealous and fervent that prayer must be. I think I may have told you on some occasion, made the mistake once in class in Virginia, telling my students that I thought a celibate life was much more difficult than the married life. All my students were lay people. There was a shout, "No!" They proceeded to tell me how demanding married life can be. In other words, we must pray and pray as much and as deeply and as constantly as our state of life requires. In today's world, that's plenty. How many times, like, say, this past week, I've complimented the people who come to Mass at 6:30 a.m. in Jesu Church. 6:30 Mass. I thank them many times over these years now. "Thanks for being here. It strengthens my faith." But I also tell them, 12, 15, sometimes 20, show up for 6:30 Mass. How we need prayer, vocal prayer, mental prayer, the Mass, the sacraments, even to stay in grace. Hear it. God can try us beyond our own strength. Not know that is not know the ABCs of our faith. That's what grace is all about. Grace is that which God gives to enable us to do what we cannot do by ourselves. Grace enables us to do the humanly impossible. And as we know, the world in which we live looks on us who are trying to do the humanly impossible as, mentally ill. I know too much psychology and psychiatry. I've counseled more than my share, both psychologists and psychiatrists. Oh, the learned pap of psychology, forget it. The trials and problems and temptations and seductions of life are too strong for our human nature, period. Either we get help from God or we become further casualties in a world that has become, in a country like ours, almost a definition of the modern world. It is a prayerless world. Then, religious life is impossible without such prayer. And there was either a large gathering of religious in the audience that I was speaking to, or there was some reason for my bringing in religious life. That's why Evelost, in my own Society of Jesus, almost one half of our members. And why a community like the Missionaries of Charity, 400 novices this year. But the Missionaries of Charity pray. You don't vow yourself to a lifetime of consecrated chastity or consecrated poverty or the hardest of all, consecrated obedience, to be told by another human being, especially as I've had over the years, another human being who is now, quotes, my superior, whom I had in theology. I know how much or how little theology he knows. He's my superior. Are you joking? I'm to obey him, submit my mind to his. Foolhardy to try to live once more the religious life without constant prayer. And one reason I put this in, I'm sure, is because of my now 24th year of teaching the Missionaries of Charity. And Father Peyton's words, remember, a family that prays together stays together. Amen. And parents ask me with young children, but my children don't want to pray. So what? Many things that my mother told me to do, I didn't want to do. So what? Well, if I didn't do them, I would pay the consequences. I think I told you, Mother Father in Virginia, who spanked his daughter, who misbehaved, and didn't really hurt her. But she told her teacher the next day in class, spanked by her father. The teacher called the police. The father was arrested for spanking his daughter. Then I have the strange privilege of being, well, authorized by the government to counsel this father. So I did. I did not tell him, don't you ever spank your daughter again. I told him, if she misbehaves, spank her again. What a mild word, how secularized our state has become. As you know, I can use another word and begins with an S too, and not secularized. Now, practical idolatry as Satanism. This, as you see immediately, is the devil's third temptation of Christ. Remember, Satan told him, I'll give you everything, the whole world, it's mine. You fall down and worship me. Then Christ told Satan, you know where to go. And notice these statements off in the classes. I'd have just so much time to prepare the classes, and so I had to jot down as the thoughts came to my mind. The world is being exploited by the devil. That is Christ's definition of the devil. He is the prince of this world. In practice, this means that the devil promises his followers worldly success. And they will succeed. They will make a lot of money. They will become famous if they just follow the devil's directions. No question. And the bottom line is acceptance by the world. In fact, those four items, acceptance by the world, publicity in the world, fame in the world, long life, ease, and pleasure in the world, those directives, or shall I say, those descriptions of how the devil tempts and seduces people are simply the words of Saint Ignatius. This is where I learned, and I entered the Society of Jesus at the age of 22. I took my final vows. I can't believe it. 31 years later. And that's why I'm here. There are certain great minds in the church's history whose insights are so profound and so profoundly practical that once we grasp those insights, your life is made. both in time and for eternity. Here is Ignatius' insight on the tactic of the devil. He had a struggle, strong, for years with the evil spirit. And once converted, then he thought he would share his insights with others. And there's a logical sequence. First, you want to be accepted by others. The one thing we all naturally fear is, well, rejection. I don't mean even open rejection, just a person we love not showing their affection towards us in return. How we want to be accepted, how we want to be loved, how we want to be cherished. Second step in the devil's tactics. Then, once we get past the first stage of the devil's technique, then we become, well, publicly recognized. In other words, is not just one person, because every person we give in to with human respect, it becomes one more step backwards. Another person we give in to, another step backwards. And pretty soon, we become victims of acceptance by other people. And once we are accepted by others, third stage in the devil's technique, we become famous. How well I know how many priests have fallen victims to this. Bishops, sadly, my work for the Holy See puts me in contact with. Famous. Hans Kuhn did not become famous overnight. Father McBrien, Notre Dame University, did not become famous overnight. Took years to develop his fame. And then finally, a long life. He is in pleasures in the world as though this is what life in this world is all about. Get all you can in acceptance by other people and accumulation of the source of pleasure and satisfaction in this world. Is it any wonder that men like Dr. Kevorkian have been created by our society? I'll never forget the woman dying of painful cancer in New Jersey. I was then in Chicago. She pleaded with me, please pray that God may take my life. She called me up 1-2 in the morning. Please give me permission to take my life, commit suicide. No. And this is our faith. But behind that faith, as we know, is our hope in a life beyond the present one. I would have gone mad, stark mad, long ago if I didn't believe in life after death. I think I can say this for at least many, if not most of you. It'd be crazy. We'd go crazy. We do not believe that our life here on earth is only a prelude for the world that we believe will never end. Whatever else the devil wants to tempt people to not believe, it is in a life beyond this one, so that the sorrows and trials, in one word, the cross of our life here on earth, as a means of reaching that heavenly destiny for which we are made. Are there any questions? Father, will you please put on
the board?
I guess on the board your address in Chicago, Illinois. The location where you have the similar session to those here. In other words, what you teach. Well, I will be going. I promised the people in Chicago I'd be coming in once a month, starting next month. On the other hand, I have been teaching in Chicago an average of every 2 weeks through the year, but I gave that up to come here. So I'd say when I'm in Chicago, I would be somehow under the aegis of the Institute of Religious Life, which is held and directed by Father James Downey, who lives in Ann Arbor. Is there a difference between proselytizing and evangelizing? If so, what's the difference? Oh. Proselytizing is Old Testament. Evangelizing is New Testament. Now, the Jews were of course encouraged to convert those who were not Jews to Judaism. But in one country after another where the Jews were located, they were strongly opposed to try to, well, convert the pagans to Judaism. And the term coined over the centuries has been to proselytize by coercing people to become what in this case the state does not want. Or again, the English word now, proselytize, means to convert people, but by, if I use the word, seducing them, persuading them either against their will or against their better judgment to become, say, Christians or Catholics. Evangelize means to proclaim Christ's teaching and then allow the truth to convert the people. I think you said that the devil is wiser than we are. Question, is he smarter, wiser than Pope John Paul II? Should Actually, the Holy Father would appreciate this question. There are two kinds of wisdom. There is wisdom in proclaiming the truth. There is wisdom to seduce people into error. The devil is much wiser in seducing people into error than many of those like us who have the truth to convert people to the truth. In other words, take for example, to mention this just in passing. We have said this on some occasion. To my 5 years of teaching at Western Michigan University, I got a job, no pay, to be chaplain to the Catholic patients in the state hospital. 3,000 patients. There must be some people there who were, well, mentally ill. My first mass on the stage in the asylum, 14 Catholics showed up. So after mass, I asked, are there only 14 Catholics here in the hospital? Oh no, how come I got only 14? Yeah, because the Protestants were paying the people good money every time they came to Protestant services on Sunday. I had no mazuma, I had no money. So, well, I could talk for hours now. When I did, you know, you've got to be shrewd, smart. And listen to this. It's not just the devil, but the world is more clever, more shrewd than we are. I hope you believe me in seducing people from Christ than we are to getting people to follow Christ. Do you believe that?
Yes.
You're more clever, much sharper. Please, once again, I guess it's synthesized a definition that is known as Luciferian conspiracy against the truth. Here it is. This is Marshall McLuhan. The modern media are engaged in a Luciferian conspiracy against the truth. The modern media are engaged in a Luciferian conspiracy against the truth. And that I subscribe to with my whole heart. And that is why the document of the Second Vatican Council on the media called Intermortifica of the 16 documents of Vatican II, that has been the most neglected in the Catholic Church since the close of the Second Vatican Council. And the reason is obvious. That document tells Catholics, tells bishops, use the media to proclaim the gospel, to evangelize. And I think I've told you on some occasion, when Pope Paul VI ordered a Camaldolese abbot to come to the United States and do something to wake up the sleeping Catholics in America, to use the media to proclaim the Catholic faith. 10 of us were assembled. The others had millions. I had zero. But I was part of the 10 people that were organized. Remember, I told you. The abbot, about a year after his first meeting with us, he go back to Rome. He report to the Holy Father what we decided. If anything happens to me, the abbot told me, I want you to take over my mission with the Holy Father. He said, look, I'm a nobody. You are a relative of Pope Paul VI. You're an abbot. Don't let me tell the Holy Father. Call him the Holy Father. 2 weeks later, the abbot was found dead in bed. And for now, over 20 years, I've been trying to wake up American Catholics to that mandate I received from the Vicar of Christ. Wake up Catholics to use the media to teach the Catholic faith. They listen. They blink. They say their prayers. And nothing. That's my mother, Angelica. And by the way, if the Lord allows me to write the autobiography, part will be my relationship with Mother Angelica. We know each other very well. Any person who has sold his soul to the devil through satanic ritual ever have the chance to regain salvation? Yes. Yes. And the first thing he must do, of course, is stop his satanic worship. And a person like this must be exorcised, and not just by ordinary exorcism. You'll talk about possession later on in the course. That is why, for example, using the Ouija board is very dangerous. Consulting these card readers is dangerous. And you never, the adverb is never, you never enter into conversation with the devil. Never. One conversation is enough. He is liable to take over. So yes, a person can be delivered. You need help. Your comments, please, on the program, nothing sacred. Is there anything redeemable about it? I did not see it. I read about it. When I'm told, however, that it is very bad. Now, there may well be something, quote, redeemable, because the devil is clever. The devil always mixes truth with error. But I can tell you this, so much of the modern world is behaving as though there was nothing sacred. Is human life sacred from the moment of conception in the mother's womb? That life sacred? Yes. Does belong to God? Yes. And Catholic churches, even in some meeting halls, there'll be more restraint and more reverence than some people nowadays practice when our allegedly Catholic churches. And I think I told you about the boy in a Catholic high school, a junior, was forbidden by his teachers. He's watched and would regularly kneel during the consecration. He's told by the principal, either you stop kneeling or you will be expelled from the school. As I speak to you, I say to myself, or tell the Lord, Lord, what would I have to say? What in your name, dear Lord, would I have to say to wake up our Catholic people to the revolution through which we are going in our country today? Far deeper than any of us, including I, can recognize. What does the church mean when using the word diversity when striving for ecumenism? Well, nowadays, the word church is used to describe what almost anybody who calls him Catholic, calls himself a Catholic, says. How will I know ecumenism? I doubt if there's a Catholic priest, I mean this, in the world, who is faithful to the Catholic Church, who has taught, and for years, theology in Protestant seminaries, except this sinner called Father Hardin. I know the non-Catholics. I love them. I've written books on them, and books of mine that are out of print on Protestantism. They write to the publisher, bring these books back. We like them. Now, I would never use the word diverse or diversity, because in good Catholic English, there's a difference between English and Catholic English. Same words, but a Catholic meaning. In Catholic English, you never speak of, say, the Presbyterians, or the Methodists, or the Lutherans, as, well, professing a diverse form of Christianity. It's no mere diversity. Sure, many things which these Protestants hold are what we believe. That's where they got it. From the Catholic Church which they left in almost 500 years in associating with Catholics. So many Protestants have become increasingly Catholicized. Great. But as religions, they're not merely diverse. And heart, Protestantism is not just different or diverse. It is in contradiction to some of the basic principles of Catholic Christianity. Like what? There are no sacraments in Protestantism. Do you hear it? They may use the word. There are zero, no sacraments. I don't say just two sacraments, or just one sacrament. Zero, no sacraments. Because a sacrament, on Catholic terms, is what Christ instituted that is visible and that confers the grace symbolized by the sacrament. No Protestant who knows Protestantism, who is sober and say three conditions. He must know Protestantism. He must be sober. He must be sane. Whatever say, and when a child is baptized, it receives sanctifying grace. No. And for the best of reasons, because in Protestantism, and I can tell you this with complete honesty, I understand Protestantism better than Protestants do. You've got to be a Catholic to understand it. They do not believe in the supernatural life. It's for us as Catholics. That's what we receive when we are baptized. So ecumenism, I think I did tell you, those of us Catholics who know what we're doing and are in ecumenism, we describe two kinds of people in the ecumenical movement. I've told you this, haven't I? Ecumenists and ecumeniacs. And I'm serious. Having served on the Bishop's Ecumenical Commission. In fact, some people really love me with a strange love. I was appointed by the bishops after, maybe about 15 years of ecumenism, financed by the Bishops' Conference in Washington. I was sent by the bishops to interview the officers of the ecumenists in the United States Catholic Conference. They were afraid. Oh no, not Hardin. Oh no. Well, they had no choice. They let me into the building. Required to spend hours. I asked them questions to make a report back to the bishops. And the bishop was spending good money financing the ecumenical department of the United States Catholic Conference. The report back to the bishops was, you are wasting your money. Because the Catholics in this ecumenical movement who are working with Protestants do not understand Protestantism. They don't really know it. So the department was closed. Oh, what I couldn't say beyond this. Thanks. Please explain again what you said about perfect contrition and the fear of God. There are two kinds of fear of God. There is what we call the filial fear of God. There's what we call the servile fear of God. The filial fear of God is the fear of offending God, whom I love. The servile fear of God is the fear of offending God because he will punish me. Now, perfect contrition means that I am sorry for having offended a God whom I love. But notice, it is not only that I fear God's punishments. Am I clear? I fear God not only because I am afraid of the punishments, but I fear the consequences of my failure in loving God. And consequently, I am sorry, and this is the essence of perfect contrition. I am sorry for having offended a God whom I should love with my whole heart. And the fear then, the fear in that case, is not the fear precisely of being punished by God, but the desire of loving God more than I've ever loved him before because I have offended him. And the statement I've quoted so often, this is God being quoted in the Old Testament. I love those who love me. Having sinned, and I'm speaking of gravely, we have lost the essentials of God's love. I am dreadful, afraid, not because of the punishments, but how I've offended the God whom I'm supposed to love. And therefore, I promise God that I will love him more than I would have loved him had I not sinned. And my dear friends, you're all sinners, and God knows who is the biggest sinner among us. It may be myself. But however much we've sinned, we owe God more love because we have sinned. We into the devil finally know who Christ really was. Well, since the devil does not have the true faith, we may say the devil, as far as the devil can know, I repeat, he has no faith. The devil, as far as the devil can, realized who Christ was, I don't want to use the word really for lack of faith in the devil. When he saw that Christ rose from the dead, and then people began to follow this Christ who claimed to be the living God. And all the persecutions of history, hear it, all the persecutions of history have been created by the devil. You told us many things about sanctifying grace. What exactly is sanctifying grace? You called it a creation of God. Please explain what it is. Can the angels perceive it? Well, thanks for the question. Using words, I mean a human being using words, in this case, I am the human being, using words, being heard, I hope, by human ears, those are yours, is no guarantee of the mind understanding what the words that you hear really mean. I can talk for hours. I've taught too many priests, too many very learned people, to repeat, sanctifying grace is a grace because it's a gift. What kind of a gift? A gift beyond all creation. In no sense does God owe us his grace. It is that gift which enables us here on earth to know and love God, to know and love God with our whole mind and heart, and in heaven to know him as he knows himself, and to love him as he loves himself, as a consequence, enjoy God as the Holy Trinity enjoys, what shall I say, the three persons enjoy each other's divine company. Should pro-life groups accept government grant money to teach chastity in schools? No. No. These programs would begin at fourth grade. Is this a guise to teach such a kid at the fourth grade level? Government money is always a guise. Government money is always a bait. Always. In German, immer. In Latin, semper. My Slav language, vše, always. That's why Mother Teresa has been so phenomenally successful. Never a penny, or the equivalent of a penny, from any government. Well, that is why, my friends, if you're going to promote the gospel, if you're going to be an apostolic Christian, and a zealous Catholic, you dare not look for money in return for your services. Otherwise, forget it. The state controls everyone who receives any financial grant. Has the magisterium truly given permission for pastors to have girl altar servers at Mass, or is this another abuse of the liturgy? Well, I'll tell you as much as I both know and may share with you. My understanding is Holy Father has never formally, in writing, approved altar girls. That's my understanding. Mother Teresa pleaded with the Holy Father never to approve altar girls. I want to think that he followed Mother Teresa's strong advice. Now, as you know, the Vatican is not just the Pope. All kinds of, they call them dicasteries, divisions of the Vatican. And they are, personnel who work for the Vatican. Pope does what he can. Without, of course, daring to identify, but there is a cardinal who is, pardon me, a mole at the Vatican. Am I clear? And, because not everybody at the Vatican has always, what a safe statement, been faithful to the Bishop of Rome. Is there still a Jesuit order training new priests? Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Pray for the Jesuits. Pray for us. Is the Vatican aware of the year 2000 problems with most of the world's computer systems? Yes, it is. But as I think I've told you, maybe more than once, for us Catholics, there's no such thing as a problem in this world. Say that again. There's no such thing as a problem. What we call problems are all acts of God's providence. Either we don't know what God wants, call it a problem. So you pray, find out, Lord, what do you want? I got a problem. So then if you pray enough, hard enough, you find out what God wants. You find out, you've still got a problem. Lord, now I know what you want, but spare me, Lord. How can I possibly do what you want me to do? Pray more. And the problem is solved. What you call problems are, I repeat, God's providence telling us he wants something done. He'll provide the strength we need to do it. I didn't believe that I wouldn't dare even stand here and say what I've been saying now. Since the Church teaches non-Catholics may be saved, how are their mortal sins forgiven without the sacrament of confession? By making, I repeat, an act of the perfect love of God. In other words, repenting for their sins, not precisely because they are afraid of the punishments, but because they have lost God's friendship and they are sorry. I tell them, Lord, you've been so good to me. I've been so ungrateful to you. In other words, expressing their ingratitude to God. Now, saying they can be forgiven their mortal sins by making an act of perfect contrition is not the same thing as saying it's easy. And that's why we should teach Protestants, as I did at the State University. If you've done wrong, tell God you're sorry. God has been so good to you, and you've offended him. When will the 12th lesson Marian Catechist course be available? Now, the Latin Catechism of the Catholic Church has been published. I would say as soon as possible. My plan is by mid-January. A priest said in his homily that no one has ever sinned against the Holy Spirit. How does one commit this sin? Well, I would say this priest is a likely candidate. As a priest, he cannot be dumb. he must have at least normal intelligence. Now it may be, and I hope it's true, that he does not know what the sin against the Holy Spirit means. It means, as we know, unrepentance, not repenting for the sin that I've committed, a grave sin against God. I think I've told you this maybe more than once. When I was chaplain in a hospital in Cleveland, the woman came with a severe heart attack, brought in, and I rushed to her to a room and asked her, do you want to go to communion? She was registered as a Catholic. No. So I asked her, do you want to go to confession? She said, no. Why not? Because my husband left me for another woman, and I've never forgiven him. So I said, well, how about forgiving him? No, I hate him. So I had to use what means I had at my disposal, and I knew she was in a fatal condition. You realize, you don't believe that there's a hell. Yes, there's a hell. And if you don't forgive your husband, you will not be saved. And I'll never forget these words of a dying woman. I'll be waiting in hell for him. And she died. I hope she was out of her mind. In other words, sin against the Holy Spirit is a sin that you don't repent for having committed. If God humiliates, punishes us for sinning, what about the just who are punished and suffer? Oh, in other words, we suffer for others. We suffer for others. And this, by the way, is one of the main lessons we should learn from our Lord. That's what Jesus did. God became man precisely to suffer for others. The others being we. And listen, you want to convert people who are sinners. See, your own kindred, your spouse, your children, those of your friends who have, say, abandoned you, rejected you, been cruel against you. Your patient suffering from them is the means that God requires for you to obtain the grace of their returning to God's friendship. Channel of grace versus punishment for sins. Are we as individuals or as a group still punished for our father's sins? Yes. I like that word still. I think by now you've suffered enough. Oh no. Never run away from suffering. There's so much, not just our own sins, the sins of others. Hey, Bill and Hillary Clinton, they need all the suffering we can provide them with. How can you tell if a person is blessed with the gifts of wisdom and knowledge of the Holy Spirit, if the person is psychic, is being psychic evil? Oh no. Now that English language of ours, same word psychic, there are at least five different meanings of the word psychic. It's not a class in etymology. But in general, psyche means to have certain qualities in the mind, in the psyche, P-S-Y-C-H-E, which literally means the soul, but generally means the thinking soul. Certain abilities, certain qualities that other people don't have. And some people are highly gifted psychically. So, how can you tell if a person is blessed with the gifts of wisdom and knowledge. The person is psychic. It's not that easy. First of all, the single most effective way of finding out whether the person's gifts are natural and therefore psychic or psychological or from the Holy Spirit and supernatural is what kind of a person is that individual. A person's moral life is the single most important way and most effective way of recognizing the gifts of the Holy Spirit and the two virtues. Over the years, how many psychic people have entered my life? How many cosmic mystics, visionaries, you name them. There are two virtues which are to be looked for. The first is humility, and the second is charity. And a person who is supernaturally gifted never broadcasts those supernatural gifts. Okay. So this Francis person, about whom, as I think I've told you, Father Fox mistakenly wrote a book called Francis. Oh no, Father Fox. I urged him, pleaded with him, and he promised me he would not publicize that Francis person. Well, he did anyhow. No question. Whatever Francis is, he does not have supernatural gifts. You don't publicize. And charity. In other words, a person is both humble, especially in respecting the church's authority, not publicizing, and charitable in spending, and the more generous the person is in spending him or herself in time, in energy, in the service of others, then you can talk about the person being gifted by the Holy Spirit. Approaching homeschooling is difficult because we are with our children all day. Is there a special prayer to our parents when we are daily attacked by the devil through our children? Only a mother could say that. Well, I don't have a prayer for homeschoolers, but I'm not sure when our next meeting is. Anybody know what day we meet the next time?
October 12th.
One person.
October 12th.
October the 12th.
Next month.
Okay. So by October the 12th, Lord willing, I will have composed a prayer and find a bishop who will give it the approval for homeschooling parents. Do you know Father Dan Heveron? He is a Jesuit. I'm sorry, I don't know him. My grandson was baptized in the Protestant church. Does that mean he's not baptized? Well, for a valid baptism, there must, of course, be water, and the right words must be pronounced. And there are Protestant churches, including, if you please, the Lutheran Synod, which is very conservative among Protestants. The Lutheran Synod ministers have a minister's manual, which they are told you can use either the words, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, or you can say, I baptize you in the name of the Lord Jesus. The second formula is invalid. So the right words must be used. The water must either be poured or the person must be immersed. And there must have been faith behind either one baptizing or the one having the child baptized. In general, I recommend when a person entered the Catholic Church and not been conditionally baptized as a Catholic, I recommend finding out what kind of baptism they had when they were admitted to the Catholic Church. And I've had Protestant ministers. After I explained this to them, then had me conditionally baptize them. They've been ministers for years in their own Protestant churches. I think it's time. Thank you. And then we have a mass in the convent, meeting shortly after 5 o'clock. Then our next class is the 12th of October. That is Columbus Day, right? So shall we pray? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Hail Mary, full of grace. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. O Mary, conceived without sin.
Pray for us, in the course of
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.